I'd like to welcome you to this very special service, a sad and special service. We're going to celebrate the life of Margaret Johnston. I'd like to lead you in prayer, and then we'll have Heather come and lead us in a song. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for a life well lived. Thank you for a loving family. I pray that you would help us this morning to receive your comfort and honor Margaret in every way that we can. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Heather, would you come, please? And if you might want to take that song home and just go over those words later on. They're extremely powerful and very appropriate. I'd like to ask Scott to come now and give the eulogy.
Good morning. I've always wanted to be like Dad, and so that's why I'm wearing a suit and tie today. And I guess there's three of us wearing a suit and tie, but good morning. This is my first COVID funeral. And it certainly isn't your traditional funeral, but we do the best that we can given the times in which we live. Dad would like me to thank each of you for being here today. I was chosen to read the eulogy because I'm the oldest child, not because I'm the best public speaker in the family. If you know our family, you know that person is Kiera. This eulogy was largely written by Dad. Margaret Elizabeth Johnston, née Moody, was born May the 9th, 1939, in Verdon, Manitoba, to Fred and Charlotte Moody. Mom grew up on a farm in Rutledge, which is approximately 35 miles west of Brandon on the Trans-Canada Highway. She attended the one-room rural school in Rutledge for grades 1 to 9. She completed grades 10 to 12 in Oak Lake, and she graduated in 1957. In the winter, Mom traveled to school in a sleigh pulled by her horse. This past winter, Sean and Charlotte and Marley and Dad and I rebuilt that very same sleigh. In September of 1957, Mom enrolled at Brandon College. She came home that September for a weekend, and her former high school principal asked if she would return to Oak Lake and teach grades 10 to 12 English and French. Mom agreed. So after 1 month of university, Mom became a high school teacher. Mom returned to Brandon College in September of 1958 and graduated in May of 1962 with a Bachelor of Arts and a Bachelor of Education. In the summer of 1959, a young farmer 10 miles north of Oak Lake attended a dance. A young lady caught his eye and they danced the evening away. The next day, as he was busy haying, he came to the conclusion that he had to enroll at Brandon College if he wanted to date Margaret. On July 14, 1962, Margaret Moody and Wayne Johnston were married in Oak Lake, and that young farmer was destined to become a school teacher. Mom taught at Harrison High School in Brandon in 1962 and taught 2 years in Russell at Major Pratt Collegiate in Russell. 4 children were born in Russell, myself in 1966, Craig in 1968, Maureen in 1969, and Lynn in 1973. In the spring of 1973, one of Mom's friends said that she could not leave Russell until she learned Pasanka, which is Easter egg painting. Dad remembers Mom, 6 months pregnant with Lynn, trudging home from her friends at 1 a.m, exclaiming, "That was the stupidest evening I've ever spent. It took 5 hours, I'm tired, and look at this stupid egg, it's a mess." Typical of Mom, she bought the equipment and the supplies needed to do Pasanka, and she perfected the art. Her creative and artistic spirit had been kindled. She developed a great love of crafting. She painted hundreds of Easter eggs. She sewed, did macrame, gardened, and quilted. Each of her children and grandchildren have one of her quilts and other things that she made. Dad's queen-size bedspread is one of her work of art quilts. Gardening was Mom's first love. She spent hours every summer day creating and nurturing her gardens. In 2003, Mom, and a little bit of Dad, won the competition for the best home grounds in Manitoba for towns with a population under 7,500. With all of her interest in crafts, she still managed to teach piano lessons. Some years she had as many as 28 students. Mom loved music and played the piano with joy and talent. Mom loved to play duets with Dad playing his violin. All 4 children can remember waking up to hear them practicing a piece of music together. Sometimes a pleasant experience and sometimes not so pleasant. But seeing Mom and Dad play the piano and the violin together was a beautiful sound and a beautiful sight. I may have to call you, Kier, to come in and fill in. In 1994, Mom passed her examinations and received her certification as an associate of the Royal Conservatory of Music, her ARCT. That was something she completed with her dear friend, Hilda Dick. Mom loved her grandchildren, and she loved spending time with each one of them dearly. Mom was blessed with 6 grandchildren, Lauren, Gina, Kiera, Charlotte, Jaron, and Marley. I'd like to share with you 3 short stories about my mom. In each one, she surprised me. The first was in the 1980s, when she gave us, as part of our Christmas present, tickets to the ballet, The Nutcracker. Needless to say, Craig and I were not impressed. Mom insisted. We went, and most of us loved the ballet. The music and the dance were so powerful. It was very important to Mom that her children be exposed to the arts. Music, dance, and theater were very important to her. When I was in grade 7, Mom was a substitute teacher for my class for a week. I was looking forward to having a fun week with my mom. She started the week off by announcing to the entire class that if I misbehaved in any way, she would walk up to me, wrap her arms around me, and kiss me on the lips. I was horrified. I was also very well behaved that week. That's how Mom operated. With her keen mind and her loving, gentle spirit, she was able to manipulate or to control most situations. When I was in university, I thought I was pretty smart. I thought I would finally be able to beat my mom at a game of Scrabble. We played many games after I had that thought, and I never beat her once. She was intelligent, with a world-class vocabulary. That was my mom. She loved all things in life that were beautiful. She appreciated life, and she approached life with her intelligent mind and her loving, gentle spirit. Several years ago, Mom started her difficult journey with Alzheimer's. Her journey was made bearable by the love and the care that she received from Dad and Lynn. One of whom visited her nearly every day. Mom passed away July 9th, 2021. I will end my eulogy with Mom's favorite scripture, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. We are thankful to God that Mom's hope and future are restored. Today we say goodbye to a special lady, a wife, a mother, a grandmother, a friend. Thank you, Mom, for all that you taught us, performed for us, how you guided us, and how you loved us. Goodbye, Mom. Until we meet again.
Thank you, Scott. That was tremendously honoring of your mom. I had the opportunity to do that as the eldest son for my mom a few years ago, and it's a great honor, but not easy, so thank you very much. I did not have the opportunity to meet your mom or your grandma. In the last couple of days, I've learned very much about her, and all of it very good. Thank you. I believe we're here for about three reasons this morning, and in the next 10 or 12 minutes, I'd like to share a few things with you. First of all, we're gathered indeed to mourn the loss of Margaret Johnston. And as has been mentioned, in some ways, a prolonged loss. The loss started a while ago, and as she and you dealt with her illness, not an easy thing. My dad was one of the sharpest men I've ever known until about 2 months ago, and he had a stroke, and now sometimes he's very sharp and sometimes extremely confused. I have a little bit of a taste for what you went through. Difficult time. I believe one of the verses that kind of shows how the family and Margaret dealt with this is Joshua 1:9. It says, be strong and courageous. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go or whatever you go through. And this last while, a prolonged time of courage. What does it feel like to not necessarily remember your husband? What does it feel like to know that you're in a place that apparently you can't get out of, even though everybody else seems to be able to? Not an uneasy time for those who are trapped in that situation, and I believe that you all faced that with courage. This verse was actually written by Joshua preparing the people of Israel to go into the promised land. And to me, I would say today we read it not only about the past, but about the fact that Margaret made that transition from a life that had become painful and troubling. As we've heard, it was many wonderful moments through the years, but these last couple of years, painful and troubling, and with courage, made that transition to the promised land that we call heaven. Margaret believed the words of Romans 10:10. I'd like to read for you. "For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved." I've heard strongly that Margaret indeed believed this with her heart. And the word justified is a miraculous word of what Jesus does for us when we believe in him. And he takes us as flawed people and makes us just as if we hadn't done anything wrong. Only God can do that, because I still remember a lot of wrong things I did, and nobody was perfect. But Margaret is now just as if she had never done anything ever wrong in her life and is in the presence with God. And I believe she likely declared her faith, yes, with her words, but like my dad, more likely with her behavior and how she treated people and what she did. And so I believe we can have some comfort in that. Another verse is John 10:27. Jesus said, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me." And a few days ago, Friday at 2 a.m., I believe Margaret heard the voice of her shepherd, Jesus. And I've yet to hear that voice, but one day we're all going to hear that voice, and the voice will be come. My grandmother, when she passed, the people that were with her, she pointed to the corner of the room and basically indicated that she felt Jesus was coming for her, and she left with him. And so sometime in the middle of the night, Margaret heard that voice, and not being foolish, said, let's go. I've had enough of feeling the way I have. So we mourn her passing greatly, but probably don't wish her to stay under those circumstances. As has been mentioned in the eulogy, mourned by her husband Wayne of 59 years tomorrow, children, grandchildren, relatives, friends. And if it wasn't COVID, there would be many people from this assembly who would want to be here today to honor and say goodbye to Margaret. Unfortunately, they cannot. Second reason I believe we're here is to celebrate Margaret's life, and I had the verse that you've already read, Jeremiah 29:11, in front of me. Well, there were plans, and she was prospered in many of those plans. I have a spouse who has more plans than anybody could ever fulfill, but I believe Margaret had some awesome plans, and God did prosper her in many of those. As again has been mentioned, to get your degree in music, and that kind of a degree, if I have any understanding of it, they just don't give those out. You earn them, and you would have to be rather knowledgeable and skilled to receive that kind of a degree. And to have a lifetime of sharing that with others and encouraging others to perform that way. I had a music teacher who did her best to encourage me to play the piano for at least a year, and I would honor her efforts. They were noble and not rewarded by any success at all, But I hope that Margaret had many students who went on to do well, and maybe there was the odd one like me that she had to say, you know what, maybe you don't need to continue much longer. I don't know. Master quilter, raised a family, master gardener, and so much more that you're aware of that I am not. Lastly, this morning, we're here to have some comfort from God's word and from each other. And the passage that I want to read this morning is from 2 Corinthians 5. And I think it fits the situation of what happened here in the last few years rather well. It says, "For we know that when this tent we live in is taken down, as in when we die, and leave these bodies, we will have wonderful new bodies in heaven, homes that will be ours forevermore, made for us by God himself, not by human hands. How weary we grow in our present bodies. That is why we look forward eagerly to the day when we shall have heavenly bodies, which we shall put on like new clothes. For we shall not be merely spirits without bodies. These earthly bodies make us groan and sigh. But we don't like to think of dying having no bodies at all. We will slip into a new body, so that these dying bodies will, as it were, be swallowed up by eternal, everlasting life. This is what God has prepared for us, and as a guarantee, he has given us his Holy Spirit." And the tent that Margaret was living in was tattered and worn, and now she is clothed in a new, fresh one that is without pain. And there's comfort in that this earthly body and mind that was no longer functioning well has been replaced by a new one. And there'll be no more groans of confusion or pain or sighs of, "Why hasn't anybody visited me?" as they went down the hall, having just been there. And that's hard for those who are visiting, and hard for Margaret. Well, that is over. She is in a new body now, and probably remembers all of those visits that you wondered if she ever remembered at all. She probably has a vivid recollection of every time you went to see her and hugged her goodbye that she immediately forgot. I have a feeling those memories are restored to her today, and she knows that she was loved and cared for in an awesome way. So no more groans, no more pain, and no more confusion. A perfect body. And I guess lastly, this morning, you are here because you are willing to embrace this process. One of the first things that we kind of deal with in loss is denial. And because you're here this morning, that won't be a stage you need to stay in very long, because you are here, you are facing the loss, and we will be placing Margaret in her place of rest in a few hours. The other parts of being angry or sad, you know what, that will come and go over the next year or so, and it's okay. If you get up and feel a bit ticked about something some morning, that's okay. And if you're living with that person who's feeling that way, it's okay. Or if you're just sad for a while and feel a bit depressed, that's okay. God is with you. It's just the process of growing through the situation. And yes, you will come to a point, as I have, to accept that I had, for 60 years, I had the most awesome mom anyone could ever have. And I'm going to see her again someday. And so today, as the denial maybe has to fade, even though it's painful, and yes, there'll be some times certainly of sadness, embrace it. Don't worry about that. Walk with it together. Talk to each other. Send each other a card, an email, a text, or a hug when you can. And you will come to that place of acceptance, and we'll go forward. And as a family, be strong. So I would like to pray for you before we move on. Father, I thank you for a life well lived. I thank you that your word is clear, that Margaret is with you today. And although those of us here will miss her greatly, we don't wish her back. We're glad that she's with you. And we just ask that you would comfort us, help the family to enjoy some fellowship together today, and to, in this next year, receive your healing and your love. I pray for Wayne in particular, that you would bless him today and on their anniversary tomorrow, to that you would be with him and strengthen him and bless him. Now we go from this place with your peace, as we have sung, and ask your blessing upon this family, for I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, I thank you for this beautiful day and for a beautiful spot. I pray that as we lay Margaret to rest, that your blessing would be upon this entire gathering, and that our hearts would be comforted by knowing where she is, that she is with you, and that as family and friends, we would walk with each other through this difficult day. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this afternoon is the point where we lay Margaret's earthly body to rest right here in familiar territory, where she knows the area and knew, I guess, for a while this would be where she would rest. 1 Timothy 6:7 says, "For we brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out." And that's the way it is. You come to this earth as a baby, and if most of us are blessed to live for 80 some years, we leave like this. A lady named Martha was questioning Jesus about the departure of her brother Lazarus, who died a lot younger, and she had some questions that I have too. She said, "Lord," Martha said, "if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have had to die. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she said, "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, who came into the world." And Martha was right. She knew that there would be a resurrection day. And we know that resurrection day is closer now than it was then. We don't put dates on that, whether it's tomorrow or in 50 years. But one day, there'll be a ruckus right here in this area, where many will rise to be with their Savior and with their Lord. And so Jesus reaffirmed with Martha and said, "You know what? Not only will there be a resurrection, I am the resurrection and the life." And I would say he or she, including Margaret, who believe in me will live even though they die. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die. I don't believe for a moment that this is the end of Margaret. Her end was not last Friday at 2 a.m. It was her transition to something much better and much more awesome, and that we'll get to see her and that one of these days when it's our turn. It says, Jesus asked her, "Do you believe this?" And Martha said, "Yes." And this afternoon, I suspect that most of us gathering here would say, "Yes, I believe that, for sure. We believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that this is not the end. This is not it at all." And after I did my preparation, there was another verse came to mind, and if I can operate my phone right, so there's a bit of a risk involved here, it should come up, yes. 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 55 says, "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" Some feel that that this is it. It's all over. And I, for one, don't believe that for a second. "The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Or therefore, or because of this, dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." And will you miss Margaret? I didn't get a chance to meet her, but you will miss her for various reasons. A friend, a mom, a spouse, a grandparent. Will we see her again? Yes, we will. I would say with Martha and the thousands that have gone since then, we stand and say,
We can shake a fist and say, death, where is your victory? There's no victory. You didn't win a thing. Our mom, our grandma is with you now, Jesus. There was no victory in death. And one of these days, we will see her again for sure. Father, we thank you for a life well lived. We thank you for your word that would tell us clearly that this is not the end. In fact, this is the beginning of the best part of Margaret's life. Mm-hmm. And one day, whether it's sooner or later, we will be again with you. And we too will have the kind of body she has now that isn't prone to forgetfulness or pain or any of those things. And she is with you. So today we mourn her loss. We commit her body to the ground. But we know that this is not the end. I pray that you would bless your people, help them to stand steadfast, as the word says, continuing to do what is good and what is right, to support one another in this loss, and to anticipate the day when we will be together again. I ask your blessing on these, your people, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we commit Margaret to the ground, her body to the ground, for a little while.
Grace, this is snowy metal, cold and pain. The unborn grass lies waiting for its coat to turn to green. The snowbird sings a song he always sings and speaks to me of flowers that will bloom again in spring. When I was young, my heart was young then too. And anything that it would tell me, that's the thing that I would do. But now I feel such emptiness within, for the thing that I want most in life's the thing that I can't win. Spread your tiny wings and fly away, and take the snow back with you where it came from on that day. What I love forever is untrue, and if I could, you know that I would fly away with you. Along the river seems to say that he'll only break my heart again should I decide to stay. So little snowbird, take me with you when you go to that land of gentle breezes where the peaceful waters flow. Spread your tiny wings and fly away, and take the snow back with you where it came from on that day. What I love forever is untrue, and if I could, you know that I would fly away with you. Yeah, if I could, you know that I would fly away with you.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in to my knees, will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.